In 2013, officers from the drug squad organized crime section clandestine lab unit seized 138 kilos of marijuana that was being shipped from British Columbia for distribution in Toronto. This was bulk marijuana, and throughout the year 2013, a total of 138 kilos of this marijuana, and they identified a person of interest. In December of 2013, with the assistance of the Financial Crimes Unit, Asset Forfeiture Section, officers prepared production orders to further their investigation. These orders assisted in identifying banking information on the main suspect. Members of the clandestine lab unit team obtained search warrants for addresses in relation to their takedown of Project Green Giant. And with the assistance of the ETF at one address and the Asset Forfeiture Unit Financial Crimes, a number of search warrants were executed, including three safety deposit bank boxes at two different banks, a commercial unit on Guided Court in Rexdale, a storage locker on Wicksteed Avenue, a private residence on Rajan Crescent in Vaughan, and one vehicle. The search warrant that was executed at the storage locker on Wicksteed Avenue resulted in the seizure of 44 kilograms of marijuana. The main target in this investigation was subsequently arrested at the underground garage of his residence in Toronto. Subsequent warrants were executed, one being at the industrial unit on Guided Court with the assistance of the ETF. Several persons tried to flee from this address and were arrested, by members of the drug squad. This industrial unit was found to have a large-scale hashish production lab. We did arrest seven people, three were released without charges, and four we have charged. As a result of the warrants at the safe deposit box, large quantities of cash were seized, as you can see on some of the photographs that are rolling through here and beside me. This cash was reconciled with the asset forfeiture unit, and it came out to be $1,945,130 Canadian, $462,000 US, 1,050 British pounds, and 330 euros. This is $2.4 million combined Canadian and US cash. And as you can see, it's mostly hundreds and fifties. It's a significant seizure from this criminal organization that was, as far as we can tell, was only operating within Canada. Although there were some US dollars seized, we have no knowledge of a US connection to this. We have charged four people: Nitesh Taylor, 35 years of Roehampton Avenue, Toronto, and he's charged with possession over of marijuana and hashish and possession of proceeds over. Antonio Sergi, age 50 of Brampton, Edward Vaskerback, age 35 of Toronto, and a fourth person, Justin Young, was charged with failure to comply with a recognizance, but none of the substantive offenses. With me here today is Detective Sergeant Richard McShane, who's the subject matter expert for the asset forfeiture. If you have any questions about that, I'll seek Detective Sergeant McShane's assistance. This is a very significant seizure of cash from a group that was trafficking marijuana within Canada. Subject to any questions, that's the prepared statement I have today.
Which one was the main suspect that you were speaking about?
Nitesh Taylor, that's T-A-I-L-O-R. And Victor will have a release for you.
What the total amount of drugs that was seized?
203 kilos of marijuana and 3 kilos of hashish.
What can you tell us about Nitesh Taylor?
He has no criminal record, and prior to this, he was not known to the police.
So prior to the shipment coming in from BC?
Yes, well, we identified him as a result of the investigation throughout 2013 and began our investigation focusing on him.
So the money, the bulk of the money that was taken, are you alleging that this belonged to Nitesh Taylor?
Yes, I am.
All of it?
The evidentiary part of that will be part of the court process, but the banking information related to Nitesh Taylor identified these safety deposit boxes being in the control of Natesh Taylor.
And you're alleging that the other three people, were they working for him, or what were their roles?
Two of them were associates, and the third one happened to be with them and was in breach of his recognizance.
So not supposed to be?
Not supposed to be with criminal activity.
The industrial unit that was raided, seized, whatever, was it being used as a factory to manufacture and to transport drugs?
All of the equipment to manufacture hashish was located within that factory, and that includes chemicals, presses, marijuana, and the packaging to manufacture hashish.
To distribute as well?
Yeah, undoubtedly to distribute. There was a significant amount there.
And there's charges coinciding with that?
Yes.
Which charge would that be? That would be
possession for the purpose.
Okay.
So how are you alleging they were working? Like, have there been arrests in BC as well?
No, that part of the investigation is ongoing. We are liaising with our policing counterparts in British Columbia, but no arrests have been made from that end.
Did Taylor have a legitimate job, day job?
He has indicated that he is employed elsewhere, self-employed as a construction person.
As like a hands-on construction person or a contractor or what?
Contractor, yes.
And have you found evidence that that's true?
No. He may well be a contractor. It's not part of our investigation.
Does the amount seized affect the charges? If he seized 2 kilos of marijuana versus 200, does that change anything, or is it still possession the same?
As the prosecutors will say, it's an aggravating factor. The 138 kilos will be an aggravating factor to the 67 kilos that we seized during the search warrants on Thursday.
And did you outline the charges?
I'm sorry?
Did you say specifically what all the charges were?
Possession for the purpose, Richard, the cash charges, possession for the purpose of proceeds of crime, that's in relation to the crime of possession of the cash. And possession of marijuana over a certain amount for the purpose of trafficking.
What's the street value of the drugs seized?
I don't get into street values. There's a significant amount of drugs there. It would be certainly in the millions. I'm not even going to get... I didn't come prepared with a street value, so rather than give you an estimate, I don't have a street value. It's a significant amount of marijuana.
Would you say that it is in the millions?
I can get you an answer before you leave today, but I'm not going to give you one until I have a chance to do some math.
This is the largest cash seizure. How does the drug seizure rank for marijuana?
We've had larger marijuana seizures, but it's 203 kilos of marijuana is a lot of marijuana at one time. I've certainly been involved personally in more volume of marijuana, but never in conjunction with this amount of cash. And as far as we know, Richard, this is the largest cash seizure that the Toronto Police, the one-time cash seizure that we've been involved with.
Just final question for me is, from when this project began till it ended, what was the total?
Of 203 kilos of marijuana.
The time frame, like when did it start?
Our first seizure was in the spring, I believe, of 2013, but the warrants and production orders and the actual project began in December of 2013. So really it's been about 3 months that the officers have been working steadily to identify this group. Yes, they've done excellent work.
And when was everybody arrested?
Thursday.
This past Thursday?
Thursday, whatever the date was.
But the seizures and everything took place back in December?
No, 67 kilos was seized on Thursday as well, and 138 during the time before that, in the months leading up to that.
Detective Sergeant, you're with financial crimes or with drug squad?
Financial crimes.
Could you mind just going to the microphone just so you're ready? Can you just speak a little bit about the significance of all of this cash being seized?
Well, I mean, it obviously goes to the scope of this criminal organization, how much they were involved in the drug trade. It is a substantial amount of money when you look at it for a marijuana investigation. So from our perspective, it is the largest one-time seizure when we've been involved working with the drug squad.
And just talk about the significance of being able to go after these alleged drug dealers by way of asset forfeiture. How that sort of tactic hits them hard.
Well, it does hit them hard, and certainly when you look at the perspective of the community, there's an expectation, you know, that we disrupt criminal organizations not only through the substantive investigations being the drug charges, but also going after proceeds that they've obtained through the drug trade and tools that they use to commit their offenses.
The suspect Taylor, or the accused Taylor, was living, you said he was arrested in a condo in a parking lot. Were they living large on these proceeds of crime, or were they living a modest lifestyle and trying to fly under the radar with it?
I don't have any information with respect to how he was living.
Is this the largest seizure out of BC? In Toronto?
The marijuana?
Marijuana, cash, everything?
We're not alleging the cash is from BC. The marijuana came from British Columbia, and no, it's not the largest seizure of marijuana from British Columbia.
Is there a pipeline, BC to Toronto?
This group certainly had their own.
Step up to the mic if you can, step. This
group certainly had their own network, if you want to call it a pipeline, that's fair, but they had their own network of suppliers in British Columbia that were able to ship this, regularly ship bulk marijuana to Toronto for distribution. So it was an ongoing process.
How long do you think it had been going on for?
The earliest we know about is at least 1 year ago. So at least 1 year, but that'll be part of the proceeds of crime investigation as well, that they'll work backwards to determine at what point they believe illegal means were being used to garner money.
That's fair.
Given, like, can you look at the amount of Canadian currency, for example, compares to the other currencies, and does that indicate to you that it was mostly Canadians buying this marijuana?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know what the indications are there. As the Staff Inspector Franks has said before, they have no information to link this to an American investigation. I mean, that could possibly be the case. But certainly with the drug trade here within Canada, they're using Canadian currency.
Can you give us an idea how they would do the shipping?
Well, that'll be part of the evidentiary matter that will be before the court, but it was a Canadian courier companies that they were using.
So they were using legitimate companies?
Yes.
Were these legitimate companies aware of what they were transporting?
No, you can see some of the boxes were plain cardboard boxes over there. That was the shipping method, plain cardboard boxes that a legitimate shipper would have no knowledge of what was inside that box.
Can you just explain to us what we're seeing in each of those pictures?
On the far right, the cardboard boxes are what we found in the storage locker, and they are similar to what was seized from the courier companies during the year 2013. There's a dark black bags above that, and they were used to seal the marijuana bags, which you can see on the bottom and on the top. They're in sealed freeze-dried type bags to eliminate odor. So they're double wrapped and then in a cardboard box. And in the bottom left of that picture is the 3 kilos of hashish. And then the next picture is just the bulk. We have to remove it from the small bags to test it for samples and then it put in the large bags. The cash you can see on the floor and these two safe deposit boxes. I'll let Shane describe that.
As you can see here, the search warrants that were executed by the Financial Crimes Unit were at financial institutions, three separate safety deposit boxes shown here. As Staff Inspector Randy Franks had said before, the majority of the bills here are hundreds and fifties, which is significant in money laundering terms. That's referred to as refining. It makes the package smaller so they're able to fit it into a safety deposit box or bulk courier.
Maybe this was covered and I missed it. If so, I apologize. But can you give us an idea how police initially were tipped off that led to this investigation?
Absolutely. Through one of the legitimate courier companies called us.
So they discovered it?
Yeah, a box opened in transit, and they called the police.
And it opened just accidentally. It fell, burst open, and stuff fell.
I don't know how it opened.
Sorry?
I don't know how it opened. It was opened. That began the investigation.
When was this?
Early in 2013.
They were flying it, or were they shipping it by ground?
I don't know the answer to that, but I would expect that it was probably ground transportation. It's cheaper. They want to maximize their profits and not bring attention to themselves.
Are there any further questions?
Great. And if you like, I will get that answer for you before I leave. Okay? Thank you. And that'll be street value of kilos of marijuana, not an ounce or a dime bag at the kilo level. That's the number I'll give you. Okay? Thank you.
Does this
and I see Deputy Chief Mark Saunders is here as well. If you have any questions of him, he's always a delight to have. Thanks, Deputy, for coming.
The BC drug trade is blowing up. Do you guys see a huge like a lot of traffic coming from that area? It's world renowned for its quality.
There has always been a trade of marijuana from British Columbia to Ontario. 15 years ago, I was involved in one seizure that was a ton of BC bud, as it's called, and so that's why I know this isn't the largest seizure. I was involved in that one personally, and it's been ongoing, and it probably will continue. We do our best to disrupt, and this is a significant disruption. Thank you.